Welcome back, everyone, to the Horror Shed Podcast. I'm one of your co-hosts, Jared. Down underneath, we have the one and only South Jersey Jason. How are you today, sir?
I am doing good, although my one eye looks smaller than the other eye. I don't know why.
You getting another migraine, you fucker?
No migraine. I don't know. Am I sleeping? Four animals and the wife on the bed. It's hard.
Kick them all out with the wife.
Oh, kick the wife out too.
that's your call.
Yeah.
Mine. Yeah. She was dealing with the dog last night.
Oh, okay. So let's talk about the Anvil Horror documentary. Did you finish it?
Not yet.
Okay. Where are you at?
Episode 3.
Okay. I sort of finished the last episode. I just got to go back for the last 20 minutes. I fell asleep. So what do you think of it so far?
It's slow. I have fallen asleep during it. Mm-hmm. The rotating fucking transitions do not need to be 2 minutes long.
Right.
And where do they find these fucking wackadoos? Like
who? The friends of Ronnie DeFeo?
The friends of the DeFeo family. Yeah. Well, the whole family was destroyed. Was there an explosion? Is the fucking house still there, idiot? Right there means I want to hear nothing about
the one guy who's like, we don't talk about that. Yeah. We don't talk about that. Although, like, the friends of, what was it, Allison? No, what was her name? The oldest daughter? I can't think of her name.
Oh, Jesus Christ, it just left me.
Come on, you're the officiant.
Yeah, I know, the older daughter.
The older daughter, whatever her name is, like, what about them? Did you like their stories, though?
Yeah, they're fine. But the second you say something stupid, I'm done listening to you.
Yeah, I like how it gave a really nice backstory to both the Lutzes and the DeFeos, and then how money-hungry George got after the movie, you know? Like, I didn't realize he let, because, oh, I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to talk about it. And all of a sudden he's like, mm-hmm. you know, and Christopher Quarantino, he friend requested me a couple of years on Facebook, and I was trying to get him on the other podcast, and he's like, yeah, I'm all for it. And then he was trying to make his own documentary. So I guess this kind of fell into place. Big difference between him and Danny.
Yeah.
You know, like, he seems more grounded.
And they're both fucked up, so just shows more evidence. Like, what really still stays with me, no matter what documentary you put out, time and time again, when they showed that gun in the sewer in Queens, it had the spent casings.
Yeah.
There was 8. I counted on the fucking screen. There was 8 shots. So, again, how did no one hear this gun? Mm-hmm. It was the same gun for all victims. So Herman Case is a fucking idiot because it was the same bullets.
Right.
How would they pass the gun down the stairs? Like, that doesn't make any fucking sense.
Right. Speaking of...
And then Ronnie DeFeo contradicted himself in the fucking thing. So you can't listen to him either.
No.
Because he went... No. Yeah, shit was moved. I heard my mom tell me, oh, this is where the stupid ghost story came from. Idiot, you just fucking said this.
Yeah.
In this same interview.
Yeah, I liked how... How about his cellmate, who was, like, in, like, 2004, and then he's got, like, this mop-over hairdo.
Yeah. Yeah, the same question still exists, and... I'm still not satisfied.
I liked it just for, like, the archival stuff, things mm-hmm. that I've never seen. That was really cool.
A lot of the pictures and clips are really awesome.
Like how the friend of the Lutzes took, like, photos while they were, like, looking at the house and everything. Yeah. And the Cromarties, I've always heard about them, but I didn't know what they looked like. It was cool to see their interview. And speaking of that, I came across on the Real Amityville Horror Facebook group today, they're re-releasing the book in a hardcover format, beautiful illustrations, and it's signed by that reporter woman.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And it's limited to 700 copies, and
Adaro, I think her name was. Yeah.
I went on the website just to see how much it was, and it's $135, but it's beautiful though. And when I went on earlier today, there was 435 copies left.
Well, so it's moving.
It's moving, yeah.
So I gotta give a shout out to Rick Paulton.
Yeah, you know, I was just gonna bring that up.
I just had him on the Haunts podcast because he went to got me a t-shirt. Fucking
How's it fit?
crazy. I'm a weird size, so I'm gonna just start collecting them.
Yeah.
So it'll be easier to collect
I
the
like
mugs
the
because I'm a,
collar and the
yeah, it's
cuffs, you
like
know.
very 70s.
Yeah, I did that. Yeah, he sent me a picture, I think it's on Sunday, and he's like, "I got him a 3X. You think that'll fit?" I think I go, "I think, I don't know.
Like
I
it
think he is."
fits, it's just short. All my shirts are
Got
short though, so
that's
there's
because you just yeah.
my back is so fucking long, it's retarded.
Yeah.
It drives me insane.
So, what did he go see?
He went to see the Haunted Schoolhouse for the
Oh,
halfway to Halloween
nice.
event.
Okay.
It's been on one of my bucket lists for a long time, and they blew him away, so I
Nice.
was
When
excited to
will
hear
that episode drop?
it. Same time ours is.
Oh, nice. Okay. Very, very cool. A little friendly competition between two.
Always. I always get, some weeks are good for the weather one.
Right.
We've had a killer couple weeks. Thanks
Yeah.
to, and again, if you're still watching, like, subscribe. We got a lot of shit coming.
Yeah.
We got to work on dates for that. That's what we need to talk about at
Yeah,
some point too.
definitely. Yeah, so we covered Amityville. I watched Evil Dead Rise over the weekend.
And
Two thumbs up.
okay, wow. All right.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. I felt the pacing was slow at sometimes. They definitely left it open for another
I
one.
heard that.
A lot of homages to Evil Dead 2. But yeah, it was really good. My favorite character in the movie was the youngest daughter. She was a good actress.
Very good.
So, but all like the kids, like the because there was three kids, the mom and then the aunt, and they were all relatable, you know, and I like that when you can relate to the character. My only gripe is all that shenanigans that was going on the 14th floor. How did no one else hear anything? But it's weird because the opening of the movie is actually the ending of the movie. It starts a day,
okay.
yeah. It starts a day after, and then it goes like the day before, whatever. But yeah, fucking gore. I mean, it wasn't like gore porn, but there was one scene with that involves a cheese grater,
I keep
and I'm
hearing about a cheese
like,
grater. Okay.
oh. Yeah, so definitely, it's streaming now, so definitely go check it out. I'm gonna attempt to watch Renfield tonight. I'm feeling a little tired,
Hey, you
but
look a little tired, bro.
dude, I'm tired. These fucking dogs.
Are you gonna buy Renfield or rent it?
Oh, I'm going to rent it.
Gotcha.
And then I'm also getting, I got a notification, my NECA Dracula's coming in the mail. It's the Universal Dracula, and it's in black and white. So, which I like, I dig the Universal lines. And so that's pretty much it. I'm trying to think if I watch anything. I watch anything else. I got Camp Crystal Lake in 2 weeks.
Yep, 2 weeks.
Weeks from, well, it'll be less than 2 weeks when this comes out. So looking really forward to it. Hanging out with Dave Brown, and then I've already priced out. Like, I only need two autographs, but the one thing that we're splitting three ways with a friend of ours is they're getting all the part two actors to reenact the campfire scene from part two. And then I'm gonna also have for $50 John Fury recite his famous monologue for part two. I'm gonna give you straight about Jason, you know, that whole monologue. So, and they record it. I thought that'd be pretty cool.
That is pretty cool.
Yeah.
Now, did you see the Steel City announcement?
Oh, Marissa Tomei?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's bigger than
That's.
Kiefer Sutherland to me. It really is.
Well, no, I think it's bigger than Monster Mania's latest announcement. That stupid riddle. That riddle was stupid, stupid,
I figured it
stupid.
out. Like, it wasn't hard.
Well, I didn't. Well, what threw me off was, okay, Ghostface is not a beast wielding a knife.
Yeah.
When I'm thinking a beast, I'm thinking like a monster, you know? I would go see Dermot Mulroney for Young Guns, not that crappy Scream Part 6, but you know, all the younger generation, oh, Scream, Scream,
Yeah.
yeah. But that's my own, that's my opinion. I'm allowed to have it.
Yep.
Don't at me.
Everyone's allowed to see. I like the movie.
I mean, it was good up until the
Yeah,
reveal.
I know. And
That's when
then he was a shitty actor too at that point too.
he just
It was too over the
I
top.
like Dermot
Me
Mulroney. It's
too.
just they gave him he was overacting, and like I just like Dermot, what are you doing?
We have Rick Paulton speaking of the devil in our chat.
Oh, look
He
at Rick
said
Paulton.
Renfield was pretty fun. Evil Dead was a lot better. Lots of action in Renfield. Oh, that's cool.
Well, thanks for joining, Rick.
Yeah, thanks for hanging out, man. I'm wearing your
And
shirt.
speaking of Rick, I wanna also just say, we tuned into that podcast this past Monday,
Yes.
and I have to give it out to Death Curse Society. They kept it professional.
Yep.
They didn't like just
It
say
wasn't a complete witch hunt and shit show,
no.
and they just want what's right, and I thought that was pretty nice.
Yeah, and also Adam Marcus, I sent him a message like just thanking him for saying what he did at the beginning. Like I finally, you know, even though like the people who know me in the inner circle know I had nothing to do with it, he made it known worldwide,
Yeah.
you know, which because you know people run their mouth.
I know.
So yeah, but so I talked with him and he said, you know, you and I were both burned. You know, I said, I hope you come out to the East Coast one day because I still have to meet you. And I said, if I know the promoter of the NJ and PA HorrorCon, if you want to come out, I will let him know to reach out to your booking agent. He said, I'd love to come out to HorrorCon and hang out with you. So I messaged Ryan Scott Weber and he's like, he wants to come out. I said, yeah. He's like, well, I do love Jason Goes to Hell. So
Who
we could,
doesn't?
yeah,
Oh,
we
I
could
know you
see.
don't, but I love
I mean,
it.
I hold a, it has a soft spot in me because it was the first Jason movie I saw in the theater. So, I mean, I like the look of Jason. I never dogged it like people dog part five, you know, something different, something different. I just wish there was more Jason in it,
Yeah,
you
me
know.
too. That always.
But, you know, we're getting that documentary hopefully by the end of this year. Hearts of Darkness. It's going to be delayed because Adam had said he's going to be showing it at some film festivals.
Oh, that's
So,
cool.
but
Well,
yeah.
everything's gonna be delayed now. This writer strike's fucking
Oh
up
man, I'm
everything.
so pissed off. What was I? What was? I mean, I know it's going to be delaying a lot of things, but like the entertainment articles were like making it sound like the show's not coming back, and you think it gets canceled. Oh, so we know it's the writer's strike, and you know what? The writers deserve
Fucking
more.
A.
Yeah.
I'm all for it.
Because
Go
if it's
for it.
not,
Get your money, boys.
because if it's not, if it wasn't for the writers, these actors wouldn't have a job, you know.
Writing's 100 times harder than acting, trust me.
Exactly. And these actors making $100 million and
Right.
these poor writers can't even like pay their rent.
Yeah, like
So,
they got to be on 3 movies to actually make a profit. But yeah, I'm all for that because, I'm not gonna say I've done acting, but I'm pretty sure it's a lot easier than the book I've been trying to write for 10 fucking years.
Yeah. Speaking of which, Dave Brown, my good friend Dave Brown, he, you know, once he made His Name Was Jason, he was like, I'm going to take a step back because it took a lot out of him for like 3 years, you know. But since then, he's always been writing these drafts for a potential story. And he's already made the announcement, which is already getting a little bit of buzz on Facebook. He came to me and said, what do you think of like a Friday the 13th meets the Blair Witch Project? And I said, as to what? And he said, like a found footage. And I said, well, we were supposed to get a found footage Friday 13th movie like after the reboot, but it just, they didn't go for it. And there is a little fan base with it. So he sends me like 2 pages of a outline, and it's basically going to take it's going to take place basically it's going to take place with anything that had to do with part one and a little bit of part two, but not so much like I don't want to give it too much away, but film school students were making a documentary. It's going to take place like in 2017, and they go missing, and we find the footage and whatnot. So he's got a little bit of buzz, and someone on Facebook reached out to him, and she happens to be a film student. So, and his director from his name was Jason's on board, and who knows, maybe
But
they'll.
listen, what I'm saying is, I can hold a mug too.
Well,
Ready,
funny you
watch,
say
ready, watch.
that. Well, maybe it'll be like they're in the diner, and the documentarians are interviewing the patrons, and they run into a grizzled old diner guy. I'll tell you what happened. Those three hunters who went into the woods back in 1980, whatever, they never came back. Okay. But yeah, I'll help out in any way. You know me, and it's, Dave got that. He just got the bug again,
It
and
happens, man.
he's got a good mind when it comes to stories. He's sent me so many different summaries for different like shorts. Like he has this really cool Texas Chainsaw Massacre one he would love to do, and he actually had the mask built, and it would be like a direct sequel from the original. And forget the one we got on Netflix. This one's much cooler. So, all right, anything else?
No, I haven't really watched anything. I just got out of prison. I
No,
repaired
you're
a
work.
machine and it was very Orange is the
Where
New Black.
were
I
you?
was in a Ohio Women's Reformatory prison.
Oh, you were actually in a
Yeah,
prison.
man, I was in a prison.
I thought you were just saying work. Oh,
No,
shit.
dude, I had to go because a lot of prisons make eyeglasses. It's cheap labor. So they pulled up in their armored golf cart. They drove me to the
Oh, my
spot.
gosh.
Guy was behind me the whole time, and every time I had to walk past like a convict, they had to lean up against the wall with their hands behind them.
Oh my gosh. Now,
So
were these women like hard looking or
no, I didn't
huh?
see one hard walking chick. So yeah,
Really?
that's why it wasn't quite Wentworth, but it was more Orange is the New Black.
Okay. You know, it's funny. I'll come across these videos on TikTok of these girls who were in prison and they want like pen pals and stuff. Some of them look pretty hard, like they'll fuck you up and not in a good way.
The guard with me was fucking with them, and
Oh, jeez.
he's like, he sent one of them to the tool shed. And he's like, try not to murder anyone on the way there, so I'm not stuck with you for another 20 fucking years. I'm
Yeah,
like,
did you get any wolf whistles from the inmates? Like, woo, fresh meat.
oh my God, no, nothing. Everyone was well behaved.
That's good.
It
That's
was
good.
weird though, man, because I'm constantly like watching my back.
Oh my gosh, that's too funny that I did not know you're at. I gotta tell Irene that she's gonna get a kick out of that.
Oh yeah, man, I was in a prison.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought you meant just work.
Not a literal prison, bro. Like they had to come get me. I had to go back there. I wasn't allowed to bring it. If I brought tools in, like if I brought my tool bag, I'd have to write down every tool I had.
Oh,
So I was like,
geez.
fuck that.
Right. You know, not changing topic, but it looks like Terry's really excited for our next location because
She is.
she scouted like a restaurant in Long Island.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Shh.
Oh, shh. Sorry.
Different movie.
Yeah. We're gonna go meet the cast from Jersey Shore.
Yep. Down in Secaucus.
That's a horror movie in itself.
I love the Jersey
So,
Shore.
it's
I
funny.
always have. I don't know why. It's the dumbest shit ever, but it's
It's it's
always
it
made
it
me
sucks.
laugh.
It sucks you in.
It does.
And we were watching Hulu. You know how like if you're watching Hulu, if you have Hulu, your show ends and then something else will queue up that you don't even watch. Well, that was the Jersey Shore, and it was the first episode.
Oh,
And it
wow.
feels like, I mean, mind you, it was probably what, 2005, 2006, and it feels so long ago. And I was just like, I can't watch it. It just sucked me in.
Yeah, I've always watched it, man. I don't
When
know.
I was on a cruise and they were like, "Where are you from?" I said, "Oh, Jersey." "Oh, like the Jersey Shore, Snooki." I was like, "No.
No.
No. They're not even from Jersey. Not one cast member's from, I think maybe one was from Jersey and that was it."
Yep.
So, yeah. All right, anything else before we get into our
Now,
two-parter?
let's get into this two-part episode here.
Yeah, so this is a story I've been wanting to tell for the longest time. We're going to do, this is going to be a two-parter. This one might be a little bit longer than the second part, but I first heard of this story back like in 1990 when I watched the, what was it, maybe NBC Movie of the Week. Like those were the days, you know, like what's it going to be this week and who's going to be the guest star? And this family must have had a curse put on them, because they've had two tragic stories. Neither has a, you know, one had a happy ending, but in the middle of the story. And it's about two brothers. And this is where good versus evil, I guess you could say. And we're going to talk about Stephen and Cary Stayner. Stephen Stayner is the good son we're going to talk about.
Good son.
So, the good son, yes. And not the Macaulay Culkin good son. He was legit a good son.
That was a crazy fucking movie, The Good Son.
I got to revisit
I remember it
that.
being really good.
Yeah, because it was, you go from Kevin to whatever his name was in this film, and like,
Very dark.
oh, yeah. So Stephen Gregory Stayner, he was born April 18th, 1965, and he died on September 16th, 1989. Was an American kidnapping victim on December 4th, 1972. 7-year-old Stayner was abducted in Merced, California, by child molester Kenneth Parnell. Let me just back up real quick. This whole both of these stories take place in Yosemite National Park in
Okay.
California. So the Stayners, their road, like the one main road, led up to Yosemite. Cary killed people in Yosemite. So, like, what are the freaking coincidences? Okay. So he was kidnapped by child molester Kenneth Parnell. He was held by his abductor 38 miles away in Mariposa County, California, and later in Mendocino County, California, until he was age 14, when he managed to escape with another of Parnell's victims, Timothy White. All right. So Stephen Stayner was the third of five children born to Delbert and Kay Stayner in Mercer, California. He had three sisters and an older brother, Cary. In 2002, Cary was convicted and sentenced to death for the murders of four women, which we'll get to in part two. So we're going to talk a little bit about Kenneth Eugene Parnell, probably one of the most despicable men I've ever read. This guy is just disgusting. He was born September 26, 1931, and died on January 21st, 2008. Kenneth Eugene Parnell was born in Amarillo, Texas, to Cecil Frederick and Mary Olive during the region's Dust Bowl era during the Great Depression. He later moved with his mother, his two half-sisters, and a half-brother to Bakersfield, California, where his mother operated a boarding lodge. Parnell was raised mostly without his father, who abandoned the family when Parnell was six. After that time, he was in and out of juvenile custody for car theft and arson. In March 1951, Parnell was arrested for raping a young boy and impersonating a police officer. He was sentenced to 4 years in prison. Parnell had lured the child through use of a deputy sheriff's badge he bought at an Army Navy surplus store. He escaped from a state institution in Norwalk but was recaptured. In a 2000 interview about his 1951 crime, Parnell said he kidnapped and molested the boy because his wife, Patsy Thornton, who died in 2018, was pregnant and that he had to find another outlet. He claimed to have been married three times, but only one record of his marriage is known. Parnell married 15-year-old Patsy Jo Thornton in 1949, had a daughter in 1951, and divorced in 1957. Later that year, he married again and had another daughter. Parnell denied in that same interview having been sexually abused himself, although Mike Eccles' book, I Know My First Name is Steven, states that he was indeed molested at the age of 13 by a boarder in a rooming house that his mother owned in Bakersfield. More than a decade after the sodomy case, Parnell was convicted of armed robbery in Utah. While in prison for this charge, his second wife filed for divorce. Parnell claimed to have married a third and final time in 1968, but no records were ever found to substantiate this. Parnell's father, Cecil Frederick, died July 31, 1972, in Denver. On the afternoon of December 4, 1972, Stayner was approached on his way home from his school by a man named Irvin Edward Murphy, who had become acquainted with convicted child rapist Kenneth Parnell, as they both worked at a resort in Yosemite National Park. There we go, Yosemite. Murphy, described by those who knew him as a trusting, naive, and simple-minded man. He had been enlisted by Parnell, who had passed himself off to Murphy as an aspiring minister, into helping him abduct a young boy so that Parnell could raise him in a religious-type deal, as Murphy later stated. Acting on instructions from Parnell, Murphy passed out gospel tracts to boys walking home from school that day, and after spotting Stayner, claimed to be a church representative seeking donations. Stayner later claimed that Murphy asked him if his mother would be willing to donate any items to the church. When the boy replied that she would, Murphy then asked Stayner where he lived and if he would be willing to take Murphy to his home. After Stayner agreed, a white Buick driven by Parnell pulled up, and Stayner willingly climbed into the car with Murphy. Parnell then drove a confused Stayner to his cabin in nearby Cathy's Valley instead. Unbeknownst to Stayner, Parnell's cabin was located only several hundred feet from his maternal grandfather's residence. Like,
damn.
Parnell molested Stayner the first night at the cabin. Parnell began raping Stayner 13 days later on December 17, 1972. After Stayner told Parnell many times during that first week that he wanted to go home, Parnell told Stayner that he had been granted legal custody of the boy because his parents could not afford so many children and they did not want him anymore. Parnell began calling the boy Dennis Gregory Parnell, retaining Stayner's real middle name and his real birth date when enrolling him in various schools over the next several years. Parnell passed himself off as Stayner's father, and the two moved frequently around California, living in locations including Santa Rosa and Campeche. Parnell allowed Stayner to begin drinking at a young age and to come and go virtually as he pleased. Parnell had also moved from one menial job to another, some of his work requiring travel and leaving Stayner unguarded, causing an adult Stayner to remark he could have easily used these absences as opportunities to flee, but was unaware how to summon him. So if you think about it, this kid was mentally destroyed.
Yeah.
Almost like a Stockholm syndrome in a way, but he sheltered him from society. So, you know, he's 7 years old when he's abducted. He doesn't know. He probably doesn't. I mean, 911 wasn't an effect then. I don't think it might have been in early stages. But I mean, he went to school. He played sports.
Wow.
You know, he had friends. They sometimes would come over, but he, you know, the places he lived in were dumb. One of the few positive aspects of Stayner's life with Parnell was the dog he had received as a gift from him, a Manchester Terrier that he named Queenie. This dog had been given to Parnell by his mother, who was not aware of Stayner's existence during the period when he was being held by Parnell. For a period of 18 months, a woman named Barbara Mathias lived with Parnell and Stayner. According to Stayner, Mathias, along with Parnell, raped him on 9 occasions at the age of 9. In 1975, on Parnell's instruction, Mathias tried to lure another young boy who was in the Santa Rosa Boys Club with Stayner into Parnell's car. The attempt was unsuccessful. Mathias later claimed to have been completely unaware that Dennis had been kidnapped. As Stayner entered puberty, Parnell began to look for a younger child to kidnap. Parnell had used Stayner to attempt to kidnap children on prior occasions, but all the kidnapping attempts were unsuccessful. This caused Parnell to believe Stayner lacked the means to be an accomplice. Stayner revealed later that he had intentionally sabotaged these failed kidnappings, thinking Stayner was an incompetent criminal. Parnell cajoled one of Stayner's teenage friends, a local boy named Sean Poorman, into being an accomplice, promised him drugs and money. On February 13, 1980, Poorman noticed 5-year-old Timmy White, who was playing outside his parents' house in Ukiah, California, and ushered him into Parnell's getaway car. When White refused and attempted to run indoors, Poorman shoved the boy against a chain-link fence, forced him to loosen his grip, then dragged him kicking and screaming into the car. Parnell made quick work in brainwashing White, as he had done with Stayner's abduction, repeatedly trying to get White to think his new name was Tommy. Parnell paid off Poorman with a promise cash of marijuana, then ordered him to leave and never speak of the incident. Parnell also dyed White's blonde hair dark brown in order to mask his appearance from the forthcoming missing child posters. Ultimately, Parnell would pass White off as his younger son and Stayner's brother. White forged a bond with Stayner during the 16 days he was held captive and spoke favorably of how the older boy took care of him. Stayner, determined to not see another child suffer the systematic sexual abuse that he endured, sought to return White to his parents. On March 1st, 1980, while Parnell was away at his night security job, Stayner left with White and hitchhiked into Ukiah. After they were unable to locate White's home, they went to a police station. By daybreak, on March 2nd, 1980, Parnell had been arrested on suspicion of abducting the both boys. When the police checked into his background, they found a previous sodomy conviction from 1951. Both children were reunited with their families that day. In 1981, Parnell was tried and convicted of kidnapping White and Stayner in two trials. He was sentenced to 7 years, but was paroled after serving five.
Seven fucking years.
Yeah. Especially, like, with his background.
Yeah.
You know, that's like a slap on a wrist. Parnell was not charged with the numerous sexual assaults on Stayner and other boys because most of them occurred outside the jurisdiction of the Mercer County prosecutor or were by then outside the statute of limitations. So this is what they should have done. Go to the jurisdiction and have it there for each,
right,
where everything happened. it's got the travesty. It's just sickening. The Mendocino County prosecutors, acting almost entirely alone, decided not to prosecute Parnell for the sexual assaults that occurred in their jurisdiction. Parnell was tried for kidnapping Stayner and White, but not for sexual abuse. He was convicted of both kidnapping and served 5 years of a 7-year prison sentence. Edward Murphy, Parnell's accomplice from the Stayner kidnapping, was sentenced to 5 years imprisonment and paroled after 2 years. Sean Poorman, Stainer's school friend who abetted Parnell in the White kidnapping, was sentenced to a term in a juvenile work camp. Barbara Mathias, Parnell's girlfriend who lived with him and Stayner for some time, was never charged with any violation and cooperated with authorities in Parnell's trials. Murphy, for helping kidnap Stayner, and Poorman, for helping kidnap White, were convicted of lesser charges. Both claimed they knew nothing of the sexual assaults on Stayner. Mathias was never arrested. Stayner remembered the kindness Uncle Murphy had shown him in the first week of captivity while they were both under the influence of Parnell's manipulation, and he believed that Murphy was as much Parnell's victim as he and Timmy were. Stayner's kidnapping and its aftermath prompted California lawmakers to change state laws to allow consecutive prison terms in similar abduction cases. So if you know, there was this great documentary on Hulu, and this is the first time I ever saw a documentary, and it was called Captive America. It's a three-parter, and this was big news. You know, this was, you know, before Adam Walsh. You know, I mean, the kid was gone for what, 7 years or so, and you know, the news crew were hounding him 24/7. They were on the roofs looking in the windows, like he could not get just time with his family. When he went to school, they followed him into school and were videotaping him, like, on his first day. And he seems like he's enjoying school. But the one thing that he really could have benefited from was therapy. And his father was totally against it because it was taboo, you know? And I think the father was just in denial. And, you know, one thing that happened, and I didn't put it in the notes here, everything was great about him going back to school. He was making friends, but then they discovered nude photos of him, and the kids automatically thought he was gay. So that was something that he had to, like, you know, the torment from the bullies and everything. His brother, if you watch these videos, his brother is, like, in the background in one of the interviews, like, doesn't even want to be there and decides to just walk off camera. Like, we'll find out in the next part. The brother, you know, he's got some mental issues, and, you know, he had to basically relearn his family all over again, because when they last saw him, he was 7 years old. He's 14 now.
Yeah.
You know, so they lost a good 7 years, and they missed some good years. You know, he's now a man, a young man. So after returning to his family, Stayner had trouble adjusting to a more structured household, as he had been allowed to smoke, drink, and do as he pleased when he lived with Parnell. In an interview with Newsweek shortly after his escape, Stayner said, "I returned almost a grown man, yet my parents saw me at first as their 7-year-old. After they stopped trying to teach me the fundamentals all over again, it got better. But why doesn't my dad hug me anymore? Everything has changed. Sometimes I blame myself. I don't know sometimes if I should have come home. Would I have been better off if I didn't? And again, that's because of the brainwashing by Parnell. Stayner underwent brief counseling but never sought additional treatment. He also refused to disclose all the details of sexual abuse he endured from Parnell. In a 2007 interview, Stayner's sister said that her brother did not seek counseling because their father said Stayner didn't need any. She added, he got on with his life, but he was pretty messed up. He was bullied by other children at school for being molested and eventually dropped out. Stayner began to drink frequently and was eventually kicked out of the family home. His relationship with his father remained strained. In 1985, Stayner married 17-year-old Jody Edmondson, with whom he had two children, a daughter, Ashley, and a son, Stephen Jr. He also worked with child abduction groups, spoke to children about personal safety, and gave interviews about his kidnapping. He joined the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints just before his death. At the time of his death, Stayner was living in Merced and working at a pizza shop. On September 16, 1989, Stayner sustained fatal head injuries while on his way home from work when his motorcycle collided with a car in a hit-and-run accident. The alleged driver of the car was later identified by witnesses. 500 people attended his funeral, at which 14-year-old Timmy White was a pallbearer. And in the interview or the documentary, his sister was actually on her way to work and saw the accident, but didn't know that was her brother.
Oh,
Like, she
wow.
saw the body and didn't know. White became a Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department in 2005. Like Stayner, he gave lectures to children about his experience and the dangers of kidnapping. In 2004, Parnell was tried for human trafficking and attempting to kidnap a child, and White was summoned to testify. Also summoned was an adult, Sean Poorman, who reacted with shock, not having seen White since the 1980 kidnapping. The two spoke briefly and hugged, White having forgiven Poorman. White married a woman named Dina and had two children. However, as with this damn story, unfortunately, he died on April 1, 2010, from a pulmonary embolism. On August 28, 2010, a statue of White and Stayner was dedicated in Applegate Park in Merced. Residents of Ukiah also erected a statue representing White and Stayner escaping hand in hand, which is a really cool statue. And it's just like, wow, it's. White was a hero.
Yep.
He died a hero, and it's just a shame. He was taken way too soon. Who knows? His helping with these organizations could have led into bigger things too. All right. So in early 1989, a television miniseries based on his experience, I Know My First Name Is Steven, also known as The Missing Years, was produced. Steven, taking a leave of absence from his job, acted as an advisor for Laura Mortel Pictures and had a non-speaking part playing one of the two policemen who escort 14-year-old Steven, played by Corin Nemec, through the crowds to his waiting family on his return to Merced home. Although pleased with this dramatization, Stayner did complain that it depicted him as a somewhat obnoxious, rude person, especially towards his parents, something he refuted while publicizing the miniseries in the spring of 1989. The two-part miniseries was first broadcast by NBC on May 21st and 22nd, 1989. Screening rights were sold to a number of international television companies, including the BBC, which screened the miniseries in mid-July of the following year. Later still, it was released as a feature-length movie. The production, which received four Emmy Award nominations, including one for Nemec, was based on a manuscript by Mike Eccles, who had researched the story and interviewed Stayner and Parnell, among others. Excuse me. After the premiere, Eccles published his book, also titled I Know My First Name Is Steven. In the epilogue to his book, Eccles described how he infiltrated NAMBLA in 1999 against the witches of the Stayner family. Eccles wrote an additional chapter about Steven's older brother, Cary, at the request of his publisher, which then republished the book. The title of the film and the book are taken from the first paragraph of Steven's written police statement given during the early hours of March 2, 1980, in Ukiah. It reads, "My name is Steven Stayner. I am 14 years of age. I don't know my true birth date, but I use April 18, 1965. I know my first name is Steven. I'm pretty sure my last name is Stayner, and if I have a middle name, I don't know it." Stephen's story was also included in the book Against Their Will by Nigel Cawthorne, a compilation of stories of kidnappings. In April 2022, Hulu released a limited true crime docuseries, Captive Audience, a real American horror story, following the life of Stayner and his family and how the kidnapping impacted their lives. Particularly Particular attention was paid to how the events impacted the life of Cary Stayner. The docuseries focuses heavily on the miniseries and featured appearance by both Horne Nemec and Todd Eric Andrews, who played Cary Stayner. And it was pretty cool seeing Horne Nemec reading like the lines from like the. So they have the man, they had the recordings of Steven Stayner, which they did use, but there was also transcripts. So they had the adult Horne Nemec reading those, which made it a little bit more powerful. 10 years after Stayner's death, the city of Merced asked its residents to propose names for city parks honoring Merced's notable citizens. Stayner's parents proposed that one be named Stayner Park. This idea was eventually rejected, and the honor was instead given to another Merced resident because Stayner's brother, Cary, confessed to and was convicted of killing four women in Yosemite in 1999. Merced city officials feared that the name Stayner Park would be associated with Cary rather than Stephen. Later became a Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department deputy. As I said before, he died on April 1st, 2010, at age 35 from pulmonary embolism. Nearly 5 months later, on August 28th, 2010, the statue of Stayner and White was dedicated in Applegate Park in Merced. Residents of Ukiah, White's hometown, carved a statue showing a teenage Stayner with young White in hand while escaping their captivity. Fundraisers for the statue have stated that it is meant to honor Stephen Stayner and give families of missing and kidnapped children hope that they are still alive. Stephen's father, Delbert Stayner, died on April 9th, 2013 at his home in Winton, California. He was 79 years old. So we're going to get back to the 2004 conviction of Parnell. So in January 2003, Parnell was arrested again for after trying to coerce his Garrett. This is such like a crazy, well, with this guy, it's not a crazy story, but the balls on this guy, you know, in the 50s, in the 70s, and in the early 2000s. So he tried to coerce his caregiver's sister, Diane Stevens, into buying him a four-year-old boy for $500. Parnell was by this time 71 years old and suffering from diabetes and emphysema, as well as other ailments brought on by an earlier stroke, requiring nearly a 24-hour-a-day nursing care at his cluttered apartment in the 2600 block of Matthew Street in Berkeley. Stevens was aware of Parnell's past and cooperated with police in setting up a sting operation that would lead to his arrest. According to Diane Stevens' testimony, Parnell requested that the child have a clean rectum, indicating sexual intentions. He paid $100 for a birth certificate and had $400 on his person for the completion of the transaction when he was to receive the child on January 3rd, 2003. Parnell was arrested that day, subsequently telling authorities, "I wanted a family." Timmy White, then a grown man, was subpoenaed to testify in Parnell's criminal trial. Although Stayner was dead, his testimony at Parnell's earlier trial was read to jurors as evidence into Parnell's 2004 trial. Parnell was convicted on February 9th, 2004 on the charge of attempting to purchase a child and attempted child molestation, even though no child had been targeted. The prosecution successfully argued that sexual aids and pornography found in the apartment, along with Stevens' own testimony, were enough to prove that Parnell's intentions were criminal in nature. He was sentenced to 25 years to life under California's three strikes law. Prosecutor Tim Wellman had largely argued his case before the jury by showing a slideshow of Stayner marked 1, then a White mark 2, and a blank screen mark 3 to show the non-existent child that would have been abducted had police not been notified. Wellman said Parnell was looking for one last hurrah, one last Stephen Stayner, one last Timmy White. Parnell remained incarcerated until his death at age 76 on July 21st, 2008, at the California Medical Facility in Bassettville, California. According to prison officials, Parnell died of natural causes. He had been under hospice care for some time. And I hope he's rotting in hell.
So it says Stayner was dead too at this time, so he passed away also?
Yeah, Stayner died early, mid-80s. They used his testimony from the original trial as evidence of the kind of person he is.
Oh, that's right. The motorcycle crash. I'm an idiot.
It's okay.
Because I was reading about his dad. I'm like, well, I got it.
Oh, yeah. So it's funny how, but obviously the laws have changed since the early 80s. They'll use Stephen's prior testimony, but at Stephen's own trial, the kid couldn't get justice because statute of limitations or it's not in my jurisdiction. This guy could have been put away for life back then if they just went outside the box.
There's unlimited stories of this shit, though. That's what's scary.
Yeah. And who knows? I mean, there could be another Steven Stayner out there right now.
Probably is.
Yeah. Well, I
Probably
was
is.
reading, speaking of like kidnapping, I've seen it on Facebook. I guess on one of the episodes of Unsolved Mysteries, there was a little girl who was kidnapped at age 6. And because of this episode of Unsolved Mysteries on Netflix, they found her.
Oh, that's awesome.
So, yeah. So this was the good son. Next week we're going to focus on the bad son. And I remember hearing about the story. It's that, you know, of course it was like on all the news, like Good Morning America and all that good stuff and Nightline. And I don't ever remember the outcome, but then I remember a couple of years ago, 2020 was doing a special on it, 'cause I think it was like the anniversary. And it was like an hour long and I wanted more. And it was such a good story. And with this documentary, they spent some good time on it too. So we'll get more into Cary Stainer next week.
Cary Stayner next week. So make sure you like and subscribe if you're still here.
Like and subscribe. And you know what? You guys are killing it with our Friday the 13th YouTube video.
Oh
If
my
you
God, yeah.
can share it, we're almost at 1,000 likes on that, or 1,000 views. So come on, help us get to 1,000. Woo!
Oh, we're pushing today. We hit like 740 or something like that. We're
Nice, good.
moving. We got the next one queued up. We just got to work on times. And I was thinking, we are close to New York City, and there's a ton of movies that were filmed in New York City.
Yeah. But
But
we're gonna
I,
need more than a day.
yeah, we'll need more than a day
I mean,
there.
oh yeah, we could go Friday the 13th part 8 for the 2 minutes it was on
Yeah,
screen.
the 2 whole minutes. I'm like, oh, that was our filming locations. The rest was in Canada, and we're not going to Canada. So see you guys later.
Yeah. I mean, there's what we got, Ghostbusters.
Oh
What
my
else do we
God,
got?
yeah, there's so many.
Chud. Yeah, I mean, the list goes on and on and on and on.
But the one we may do after this one may take us a little south.
Okay, I'm drawing a
Oh yeah,
brain
well,
for.
we're not giving them anything. I'll
Well,
text
I
you.
don't even know.
I
Yeah,
know.
text me.
Very easy to get to.
Okay, sounds good. So we yeah we before we close it out, we're officially halfway to Halloween, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So do you have any pre-haunts before the season starts that you're going to?
There's one Saturday, but I don't think I'm gonna go.
Where's that at?
It is Hackney's Haunts in I think it's Hackney's Haunts. Or is I forget. Laurel's House of Horror, that's what it is. It's a Laurel's
Okay.
House of Horror. It's a haunt that
Oh,
took
I remember you
over
talking
a
about that.
movie
Yeah.
theater, which is kind
That's
of cool.
cool.
So that's down
Yeah.
near Baltimore. But I think we're done for the year. We're gonna just start saving up, get our schedule ready, get our videos ready, get our tons
So
of Google Docs ready.
are you gonna send Rick Paul in a H265 shirt? Awesome.
He
You
doesn't
gotta
know that
represent.
yet. He might have just
Oh.
heard
That's awesome.
But I
He's part of the
gotta ask him for
family.
the address anyway, so he knows it's gonna come.
Well, you should have his address. He mailed that to you.
Ah, shit.
Yeah.
And my wife did say his address is on there. Well,
There you
Rick, you
go.
got something coming. Ah, fuck it, though.
There you go.
But
All
yeah,
right.
I'm gonna reach out to some haunts in his area and see what I can't get him to.
Nice.
Yeah, so we got anything else?
No, but I'm good.
Damn, our shortest episode ever.
I thought it'd be a little bit long. I try to,
I
you know,
know,
make
that's
it.
fine. We'll leave him in
Yeah.
suspense. I'm cool with that.
Yeah.
I am cool with that. We got news for us. We're working on that one video. We're working on that other video. We may be able to do them at the same time.
Okay.
Because I'll talk to you more about that in a little bit.
All right.
Because I have an idea.
Okay.
We could kill a couple birds with one stone.
Sounds good.
And it cuts down on the driving for you. So
Okay.
maybe we could get Irene to come.
Yeah, we got our animals though.
Oh, yeah, you won't be overnight or anything.
Well, yeah, but it'd be a long day.
Oh my God, they'll be fine. I swear to God, your dogs will not starve to death. The cats will not starve to death.
Well, I'm not worried about the cats, it's just the dogs. Typically one dog.
They'll be fine.
Yeah. All right,
Get
sounds
one of
good.
those auto feeders.
Yeah. Like in Back to the Future with the alarm of the dog food.
My dad has one for the cat.
Really? Well, this is not a cat, it's a mountain
Oh, yeah, his,
lion.
yeah. But yeah, I think we might even have one that we're not using. I'll talk to Terry about it. But guys, we're just rambling. Our Shed Podcast every Monday. Like, subscribe, follow us on Twitch so you can watch us ramble and screw up and stuff. But we will see you guys next Monday. Goodbye.
Halloween Horror 365 production.